And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another beautiful, sunny, so far, Saturday morning. And here we are, the entire crew, as you can see here with Saturday Morning Cartoons. Hope you guys are joining us. Everyone that we can see us, chime in. We are expecting some technical difficulties only because we have something. Can anybody pronounce the name of this hurricane, please?
Isis?
The big hurricane. That's what I'm calling it.
I've heard so many pronunciations. I don't know. Hey, Jerome, on your watch party, do you have any huge pixelations that's going on?
No, I had to boot out because it wasn't logging in.
Okay, well, this is, I got some, like, you know, massive pixelation going on. I don't have any images at all. So
leave your watch party and even exit.
Yeah, because mine looks fine.
Yeah, mine looks fine. Leave your watch party and leave your Facebook app also on the phone. You may even have to reboot your phone sometimes.
Yeah, I'm going to try it again.
Morning, Charles.
Yeah, hey, Charles. How you doing? Oh, look, I'm fine now. You're right. I just did that. I left it and came back in. And
maybe call the hurricane Pain in the Aces.
No. It's a Aedes, Isa, Aedes, Usa, Misa, Biza. I don't know.
Who cares? It's the letter I. That's the more important thing guys should be worried about.
It's the I of you know. Well, anyway, so we have this thing coming, and it's really interesting. Floridians doesn't affect them at all. There was a massive surge of grocery store shopping at the grocery store yesterday after I got off from work. And I constantly scratch my head because it's the same thing each and every hurricane, whereas, you know, you're buying for a week and hurricanes, you know, they can, you know, incapacitate us. But sometimes you go back to the grocery store the next day. So you got all this stuff
that's
going
the first
on.
Thing they open is the grocery store, you know.
Yeah. Well, Charles, we've been getting a heat wave for like 25 years, so I don't know what you're trying to say. You know, Charles said, "Oh, we're having a heat wave." Okay. So, and for most Floridians are really, really happy when a hurricane comes by because the boredom of sunshine and heat, you know, we're just tired of it. We need something to break up the monopoly, and hurricanes always do it for us.
Can we clarify something important here, though?
Go for it.
Mark and Rose are in Florida. I'm not.
Yeah, you're not, buddy boy, but I think all the great whites have found you, okay? You're obviously all up there, and, you know, we haven't had a shark attack down. Well, I mean, we get shark attacks down here, but, you know, nibbles on the foot.
First off, they want the cooler waters. You know, the waters are getting kind of warm down there.
Yes, okay? That's true. They want the cooler water, so they come up, they go and vacation up north.
Right, and then they fly. They don't know this, but they're going to Nantucket. They're hoping to see a celebrity or two.
Right, got it.
And they're also hoping to see that guy who was in that famous movie In the Water, you know, in 1975.
Yeah,
you know?
I know who you're talking. Yeah. About. Well, you know, if your sharks had any freaking sense, they'd have a mask on. That way, no one would get bit. So I really don't understand how anybody at this time is getting bit. Okay, so that's basically what's going on. Okay, look, it's my turn.
It's gonna suck.
This is gonna suck. As much as it may actually suck. But as much as it comes around to being my turn, I really get how monotony can play a part in anyone's mental health. So in salute of all of our mental health, this will be our last show for a month. We're gonna take a summer vacation. We're gonna take a hiatus. I mean, dag nabbit, we can't do anything on Saturday mornings because we have to talk to you people. not that we don't love that. We love talking to you people and sharing our cartoon history with each and every one of you. Hello, Mr. Bagley, guys. Terry over in Ireland. Good to see you guys here watching us. But we're going to take a break and a much needed break.
I believe they call that a hiatus.
It's a hiatus. Yes. I wonder if that's an Indian term.
I don't know, but it's what they use in TV land.
Yeah. We're taking a hiatus and we're going on summer vacation. If they can take off and actually it's, the big week in television is like in May, right? And then they basically show when's the last new episode of any series basically shown?
Used to be just before Memorial Day, but now they string them out in such a way that you don't get those repeats as often.
Right.
I mean, the summer repeats when we were a kid were basically when school was out and then they restarted on Labor Day.
Yeah.
Right.
That's true.
Okay.
Yes.
And then you would have the sweeps of
May.
November,
March,
November too, I think.
March and May were usually the sweeps weeks.
Uh-huh.
And what would happen was the TV shows, you'd get 13 weeks. The first your show used to be guaranteed for 13 weeks. Tim Conway made tons of jokes about that because he had a lot of shows there. Yeah. But it was from Labor Day till just about Christmas, and then they would take the holiday break on your shows, and at which point the networks would sort of had been looking at, you know, when are they going to cancel, and you would start any, you know, mid-season replacements would start, you know, usually about January 15th or thereabouts.
Right, right.
And then it would go till about Memorial Day, and then all the summer, during the lovely 70s, and this is the part I loved, in the 70s, you'd get all those repeats that you missed, and if you were really lucky, depending upon the network, they would run the movies or the pilot shows of everything that they had been submitting as filler, and you'd see these really interesting movies as a potential pilot that never got picked up.
Yeah.
I missed pilots.
Yeah. Okay. so basically we're going to take some time off and we're going to come back with some brand new stuff, brand new material, you know, whatever you can come with. But it's probably appropriate that we end it with one of many of my loves coming out of Hanna-Barbera. I want to warn the people that are watching us here that our parent company, and it's really not our parent company, it's really our partner company, HWWS, has actually petitioned Warner Brothers, and I think they did NBC, with a letter basically saying, hey, leave us alone. We're promoting you. We're talking about you. We're worshiping you. So stop blocking our material because we're not making any money off of this. So we're not harming you at all. And I have yet to hear back from anyone yet as to what the results of that was. But
well, that's great that they did that, though.
Yeah, it is. And in fact, Garrett emailed me and said, look, I'm going to try something. And he said, I'm going to, you know, write this letter and tell them basically what I just said. And so the material that we're showing this morning is, in fact, Warner Brother material.
Okay.
And I'm going to push off some of the videos for as long as I possibly can. So that the fact that we don't get knocked off or anything like that, anything happens to us. So, you know, bear with us as we talk about today's entry, which is my entry, which is the Herculoids. And I want to preface this by saying a lot of us grew up with Tennessee Tuxedo, Huckleberry Hound, a Magilla Gorilla, literally the comedic end of Hanna-Barbera. But it wasn't until the mid-60s, a little further into the 60s, 67, 68, did the networks decide, well, not the networks, I'm going to say Hanna-Barbera, decide, hey, we need to focus on some superheroes. Let's do some superheroes, you know, whatever. I think Marvel had a little bit of a success with their Marvel superheroes, which was some really funny-ass animation, I have to say. If they're standing still and only their lips are moving, or if Thor used one arm to throw his hammer without putting his foot backwards and going into a rotation, you know, if none of that happened, that was early superhero cartoons, shall I say, via Marvel. So that's what we saw back then. But I decided to focus on what Hanna-Barbera's huge success with superheroes was about. And it's really what gets, which really got me excited. In fact, what we're talking about today is not even going to be, it's not even the first Hanna-Barbera superhero cartoon that made everybody stand up and say, holy crap, look at this. It was actually Space Ghost. Okay. But because of the success of Space Ghost, they went on and branched off and made more superhero cartoons. One, preferably what I'm going to show you guys today. And that is literally the Herculoids. Okay. I am an incredible huge fan of the Herculoids, mainly because I've always been a huge fan of ensemble groups, AKA Avengers, AKA Justice League or Super Friends, whatever you want to call them. I've been a huge fan of ensemble groups. Thus, the Herculoids came about. And it's like, well, this is a different kind of ensemble group because we all expected human beings. Well, no, this was an ensemble group of not only human beings, but the focus was more on the animals, the non-humans that were in this group. So let me go ahead and talk a little bit more, of course, about the Herculoids. The Herculoids battled to defend their planet from menaces on Quasar and from outer space. All of the Herculoids displayed human-level intelligence, employing precision teamwork and complex tactics, as well as emotion. And Xandor and Tara both displayed a working knowledge of complex alien technologies, as well as the ability to pilot interstellar spacecraft. But essentially, Xandor, Tara, Dorno, and the Herculoids were all apparently fighting to keep Quasar a technology-free, primitive planet. This is further indicated by the pseudo-barbarian outfits of Xandor, Tara, and Dorno, and the fact that technology was used mainly by the various villains, but rarely, if ever, by the heroes. Now, one of the hard things with me doing a show myself and running the board is I can't freaking advance any, hold on, guys, any photos here without kind of doing that.
I have a question then.
Go for it.
You said that they could fly, you know, fly interstellar ships. I never recall ever seeing them flying a ship.
And that is absolutely true, because when I read this, and I didn't write this piece that I'm reciting right now, but when I read this, I'm like, when did they do that? I said the same thing, but I still left it there because I wanted to kind of emphasize the fact that they weren't quote unquote pet owners. Okay, I guess I want to call it. But in fact, they were from an advanced race. Now, the world of Space Ghosts and the Herculoids, okay, is in a different timeline than something else I'm going to show you guys later during this show. And you gather us in the future, although if you think of Star Wars was in a galaxy long, long, you know, long way. Well, that was advanced technology before, I guess, Earth was even born or something like that, or at least you get the impression of that during Star Wars. Hell, Star Wars could have happened during our medieval ages, okay? Right. Even during our prehistoric ages, when Battlestar Galactica decided they finally found Earth, look what they ended up in, okay? Which I'm still scratching my head over and still a little pissed off at, okay?
Wait a minute, which version of Galactica? Because
the newer version.
In the old version, they got the broadcast of the lunar of Apollo 11 landing, but they ended up in finding Earth in the 1980s.
Yeah, well, yep, it was the 80s, and Galactica 1980 came around. I remember those flying motorcycles. I'm like, yeah, right. Okay. Yeah, sure.
Whatever. Come on, tell me you didn't want one of those.
Well, I watched everything, man. I when it's sci-fi related, I watched them all. So
yep.
So let's go ahead and talk a little bit more about Herculoids here. You need to open a full screen here for me. Although the speech of their companions was limited and repetitive, Xandor, Tara, and Dorno demonstrated that Gloop and Gleep, at least, had a comprehensive mode of communication and that they could at least understand and interpret this language, okay? The voices used in the shows were actually brief tracks supplied by two actors and reused throughout the series in keeping with Hanna-Barbera's thrifty ethos, and which I understand because we do hear repeats of certain words, terms, noises, especially in a lot of Hanna-Barbera cartoons. And the fact, if you think about some of the classic old Hanna-Barbera cartoons where we saw animals as speaking, walking, upright figures, when they ran, their arms were always tight to their sides and never moved. It was only their feet that was rotating through the series. So that really cracked me up. Anyway, a number of episodes featured alien invaders who came to Quasar to seek revenge against Xandor for an unspecific battle or adventure from the past. All were apparently technocratic, and the aliens' grudges seemed to be basically boiled down to them being stymied in their attempts at bringing technology to Quasar, which apparently, you know what? I should have read this paragraph. I don't even like it. The show's opening theme was a fully orchestral composition suggesting uncommon heroism, and an alternative opening theme was also utilized for some episodes. All of the show's incidental music was recycled from Johnny Quest. So I am going to actually go ahead and play you. I didn't have this ready. My apologize. Go ahead and play you the opening theme of the Herculoids that we already know, and then the alternate opening theme to the Herculoids, which, of course, if you're a fan of the Hercules, you already knew this. But for some people who never saw, who never saw Hercules as much as I did, probably didn't. So let's do this. Let's bring you down. Let's look at our lovely co-host. Well, wait a minute. That wasn't a good idea. Let's go back to looking at something better. Oh, darn it. I didn't put Solo. There you go. Now you're intrigued. Okay. Anyway, I have to drop this anyway. Hold on. And I'm juggling screens here. Let's drop you guys. Now, this is the opening sequence that we know and love of the Herculoids. And then after this, I'll go ahead and play the alternate one. Now, I just love this opening only because it introduced us to a whole unusual group of animals that actually had, quote unquote, superpowers. And we, as a kid watching the Herculoids, it's like, that's an ape. Oh, my God, it's an ape. And you never knew at the time until you listened to some episodes that he was a rock ape. He was a giant rock ape, which basically made him invincible. You know, if you think about it, nothing could hurt him. Of course, and then you saw my favorite character, and I'm going to go down to I'm going to show the second one, the alternate intro next here, and then I'm literally going to talk about the creatures. Okay, so take a look at this, and I want you guys, Rose and Jerome, tell me which one you like better. Okay, here we go.
Xandor, their leader, Igu, the giant rock ape, Zok, the laser ray dragon, Dorno, Loop and Gleep, the formless, fearless wonders, Control the tremendous. They team up to protect their planet from sinister invaders. All strong, all brave, all heroes. They're the Herculoids.
Okay, so Jerome, which one do you like better?
Well, I like the first one much better than this one.
Oh,
this one felt like I was being dumbed down.
Yeah, because they're explaining everything to you verbally. How about you, Rose? What did you think?
I actually like the second one better.
Ah.
I like the old timey narration, and to me it introduces the characters. If I'm a new person watching the show and I walk in, I'm like, what's this? If you know, I did like, is that Ted Knight doing the opening?
Not that one. No. But we're going to get to something shortly. I'm going to talk about in terms of narration and things.
I don't know if you noticed. When they did the introductions of the characters, right?
Yeah.
They didn't introduce the wife.
Yeah, true. Okay? Yeah.
They didn't. When they talked about the critters, they didn't tell you the name of the dragon or the two globs.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, I totally get that. So, okay. So it's good. It's good that there's a split because, you know, variety is a spice of... actually, do they say variety is a spice of evil? They don't say that. No. Variety is a spice of life. There you go. The hurricane is doing it to me.
It's that low pressure coming in.
Yeah. Oh my God. Yeah. Pressure on my head.
You definitely need this month off coming up.
Oh, I do. I definitely need it. All right. So this was one of my favorite cartoons, guys. It is high in the realm of Space Ghost. Mainly the top three we're talking about right now, which is Johnny Quest, Space Ghost, and this falls into that category as well. So let me tell you guys a little bit about the characters, okay? You got three humanoid characters, okay, who were the only ones who could communicate in English. I read this like, well, what else would they be communicating in? You know, it's Japanese? Anyway, you know Xandor, okay? Xandor, of course, is the leader, and he was voiced by Mike Rode. And if you don't know who Mike Rode is, Mike Rode had a really large history, in my opinion, in terms of just regular acting, not just voice acting. But once he got into voice acting, he really voiced some really incredible characters, shall I say. One who you may have knew and may not have known, okay, was probably his most famous narration only because he was in my favorite cartoon. He was the voice of Race Bannon.
Mm-hmm. Ah.
Okay, so Xandor himself, okay, was in fact the voice of Race Bannon, and that was just he was just in so many voices that I'd have to tell you. Oh, you okay, buddy? Here, let me mute you while we watch you die. We don't want to hear you die.
Yeah, don't die. Please don't choke.
Yeah, don't choke to death. Yeah, went down the wrong pipe, Jerome. I'm sure. So don't say anything. Just cure that. And you'll be good, buddy boy. Okay, so his voice of Xandor, Z-A-N-D-O-R, Xandor. He's the protector of Quasar, and he's the leader of the Herculoids. And, of course, next you have his beautiful wife, Tara. And she was voiced by Virginia Gregg, and he, of course, is Xandor's wife. Then you have the son. The son is Dorno. Now, Dorno was voiced by Ted Eccles in the original series, and then Sparky Marcus in 1981. Which the Herculoids was revisited again in 1981 with a few new episodes. He's a son of Xandor and Tara. Despite being their son, he still refers to them by their first names, which I never got. Rose, does your daughter call you by your first name?
No. I don't like that.
Jerome, are you okay now, buddy? I'm going to unmute you here. Okay, hold on. There you go.
Does
your daughter call you by anything other than... Dad, my turn.
The answer is not a chance in hell. However, I have a theory about this one.
Okay.
All right. So, obviously, if you look at the picture, he and mom are definitely related. You can see that.
Yeah. Blonde hair.
Yeah.
Oh, I know where you're going.
I don't think Xander's the father.
Wait a minute.
I think it's the stepfather thing.
That's in the 60s. You can't bring that stuff up, man. What's wrong with you?
Sure I can. It's called the Brady Bunch.
Well, I should have said something like, and Xandor, his bastard son, you know, something something like that. Yeah, you are right. They both have blonde hair, and he's a redhead.
Yeah.
And I love redhead. He's just the wrong species, I guess, for okay. So anyway, so he still refers to them by their first name rather than mother and father. However, this changed in the 80s revival of the series. He did, in fact, call them mom and dad, mother and daughter.
Well, that was you know, family values then, you know?
Yeah, well, I think it was a slap across the head. That's what I think that was. Family values my ass. Okay, so we got through all of the human characters on this, and you have to assume that they, if you want it, because there's no backstory on this, but believe it or not, and this is for another show, there is, in fact, a backstory on Space Ghost. Okay, a lot of people, I've read it, I've seen it. Space Ghost used to be a cop.
Where did you see this? That's what I'm asking.
Well, I'd have to find it for you to tell you exactly and give you the link to it.
That sounds cool.
Space Ghost was actually a space cop. He is a police, or formerly a police officer. Thus, remember, formerly a police officer.
Uh-huh.
By today's standards, he would be considered a vigilante.
Uh-huh.
You know, going around beating up on aliens from other planets and whatever. But yeah, so there is not a backstory in a Herculoid. So we're kind of forced to create our own, although there has been a crossover episode with the Herculoids and Space Ghosts, believe it or not. I forget the name of it. Something, something of the Molten Men. I forget what episode.
I think I remember that one. It's vague.
Yeah. Oh, let me advance the, because we're going to my favorite Space Ghosts.
I love that they both use a slingshot.
Yes. You know? I love it, and it's like they're explosive pebbles, pellets, whatever the freak they're shooting.
I want to know where they're finding the explosive rocks.
Well, hold on. Let's stick with Xandor since we're talking about Xandor. Who has the precision, skill, and athleticism to freaking rebound off of freaking elastic cores that are hung in midair?
I have a
possible solution. I knew you would. I knew it. Go ahead.
I think because of the nature of the critters and how they all and everyone else moves, I think it's a low gravity planet.
Could be. It could be a low gravity planet. You're absolutely right.
Which is why the kid can do what he can do, you know,
well,
and why
I
they're
still
able
think
to, you know.
Xandor is pretty incredible because when he's rebounding off an elastic band in the middle of the freaking forest or wherever he is, he's catching it with his feet, both his feet. He's catching it with his freaking back.
Yeah.
Okay. And it's like he knows where to propel himself, you know, forward. And I'm like, wow, man, this guy should have been on the Olympic team or something. You know, he was just
that's what I'm saying. And first off, with a low gravity planet, he can keep his fantastic physique longer. And look at her. I mean, she's looking great, you know.
Oh, dude. Yeah, okay. This is one
gravity
thing.
Is not impacting her whatsoever.
Let me tell you, you know, Rose, I'm gonna ask you the same question. I hope you know this. I'm gonna be disappointed if you don't. Jerome, you should know this. I'm going to be disappointed if you don't. You do understand the term slash.
Yes.
Okay, now stop. Don't go any further with that. I have seen some artwork of this woman, okay, that would rival any slash occurrence or anything like that. I saw a piece of artwork with her laying down forward on gloop or leap. And I'm like, that ain't right.
I have to agree with you on that one. That is so
my daughter says, if you can imagine any character, there's slash about it somewhere.
Oh, that's
yes.
True.
Yes, that's true. I agree. Oh my God, I hope nobody picks.
And she has actually proved it to me.
Well, I just hope nobody did Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck. No pun intended.
They probably have.
They're probably out there.
Yeah.
Hey, what? Listen, can I just do one little quick shout out to somebody?
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Sonya and Russ are on my watch party, and they recently got married.
I dated Sonya. Another timeline, but I dated her once. And it's when, and it was Space Ghost, who was the space cop then, who saved both Sonya and I from Gloop and Gleep. I'm just saying.
Okay. So Russ and Sonya got married recently.
Okay. Congratulations.
I just wanted to do a shout out and congratulate them on that.
Wait a minute. You know? Wait a minute. Hold on. Hey, Sonya. Okay. I'm still here, baby. I'm still here. Okay. Anyway, so all right. So let's go down to we're still talking slash here.
Yes, sir.
No, we're not.
Sorry.
We're done with slash. But
thank
let's go
God.
Ahead and talk. This is my favorite animal of the Herculoids, okay? And it is
Zarnar?
No, not who?
Who do you got showing up on the screen?
Oh, no. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do that. Hold on. Wait a minute. I can't. You know what? Let's just keep this one here. So you can't be confused at all, okay? All right. My favorite animal of the Herculoids is Zok, okay?
Which one's now, Zok?
Okay, now bear with me, okay? Suspend your believability and just listen, okay? Zok is a flying space dragon. He can emit laser beams from his eyes and I want to say butt, but it's actually his tail. Okay, same location. His eyes also produce a nega beam that can neutralize certain energy attacks. Zok can survive in space unaided, is capable of interstellar travel, and can breathe fire. I want it. Okay.
I know who he is.
Who? He has a secret identity?
He's got to be in Mild the manner. Lineage. He's got to be in the lineage of King Ghidorah.
Oh, you're right. If Ultraman showed up on this planet, we don't need Godzilla because we already got.
Yeah, but King Ghidorah's got the three heads, you know.
He's got Oh, you think that's one of the heads that's split off? And
no,
and
I think that's either like a grandfather or a father or something, you know.
Oh, I see. I like my analogy better. All anyway, right. So that is Zok. Okay, and then the next probably be my. Oh my God, I rated Zok as my favorite. I'm gonna eliminate that. And I'll tell you why in a minute. I'm going to eliminate that because I like this character, but he isn't my favorite. And here is a discrepancy. Mike Rode not only did the voice of Xandor, but he also did the voice, okay, of a number of the creatures, which I'm going to argue with. And here's a discrepancy. The next character belonging to the Herculoids is Igu. I-G-O-O, Igu. Now, in my research here, and I have yet to verify it, my research says, but I can get it because I hear it. My research says that Igu was voiced by Ted Cassidy, who we all know as Lurch in the Addams Family movie, Star Trek episode as well. When I hear Igu screaming, yelling, trying to voice, put a damn diaper on me or something, I can hear Ted Cassidy's voice in that. Okay, Igu is a rock ape. No, he's not in a band. He's not in a band. It has everything to do with his consistency, what he's made of. He's an extremely large and powerful simian. He has extremely dense, rock-like skin and is nearly invulnerable to harm. In one episode, Igu wades through a pond of molten lava. Igu has a great fondness and devotion for Tara, pervert, and would do anything for her. Okay, so let's go back to these figures of Igu. Take a look at his arms. Here's one. Take a look at his forearms. Good God, man. How'd you like to be hit by that?
Well, isn't that the Popeye effect?
Yeah, his spinach did it. Look at
there
that.
There you go.
You see, he's strong to the finish because he eats his spinach. But Igu, and I'm trying to find some... property artwork from there you go. Look at those arms. He is an incredibly strong simian, but he's not my favorite. Okay. He's not. And I said Zok was my favorite. I think I may have to eliminate that. So let's get back down to second favorite, maybe. Second favorite?
I don't think you can make up your mind, Mark.
I think, you know, in all honesty, if they all ended up a tie, I would be happy. Look at this boy. I'm just trying to find a similar. Look at this boy in the background. Okay. The next Herculoid that I want to present to you guys, his name is Tundro. And he's also mentioned as Tundro the Terrible, I think. All right.
He's my favorite.
Yeah. Check this out. Now, I already told you about Zok, who has lasers coming out of his button eyes. I told you about Igu, who's just basically invulnerable because he's just a piece of stone. Tundro is a 10-legged. Yes, I said 10. Count them. Is a 10-legged. Is five on each side. Is a 10-legged, four-horned rhino / triceratops hybrid. He can shoot. He can shoot explosive energy rocks from his cannon horn, okay? His natural armor plating is exceptionally strong, similar to Igu's rock skin. His legs have the ability, they have the ability to extend to a remarkable length, somewhat like stilts. He can also spin his head at blinding speed. I saw that once. I did see that in the episode. He can spin his head at a blinding speed, allowing him to drill through solid rock. Uh-oh, look out, Igu. And has the ability to make magnificent leaps. That is Tundro. That is one kick-ass rhino. Go ahead, Jerome.
Well, first off, he's more of a Triceratops than a rhino.
Okay. I would think so. Yeah. Yeah. Because of the plating.
But let's just call him what he really is. He's an organic tank.
He's an organic tank. Yes.
You know,
I love it to death. But let me tell you, there's an episode. I'm going to get the name of it wrong, but he's captured and he's put behind bars. And I'm like, Tundra, if you're the kick-ass you're supposed to be, why don't you just run forward?
He does. I remember that episode, and he does.
Well, he shouldn't have gotten there in the first place, okay? Look
at
this.
But it was an energy, it's energy vendor versus metal, so that's probably why, you know.
Well, Igu, I think he's got personality disorder syndrome because he doesn't remember a lot of times, you know? You're virtually invincible yourself.
I looked at him, and I kept thinking, like a Triceratops and a centipede had a kid. Is how I look at him, you know?
Well, look, this is how Xandor reacted to Igu not getting out of that cell. Really? Seriously, Tundra? Really? You know? So Tundra is one of my favorites. So, all right. I've been waiting for this one.
I know you have.
I think, first off, whoever the creative genius was who came up with these characters should have a statue erected in their honor. Okay. These are two protoplasmic characters known as Gloop and Gleep. And they were both voiced by Don Messick, by the way, a well-known Hanna-Barbera voice actor. Yeah, Don Messick, which I don't know. I can't even do it. They are able to absorb and deflect energy blasts and laser beams, often placing themselves between attackers and other Herculoids to act as shields, which if you think Igu, was invulnerable, look what these boys can do, okay? They can also form shapes, including but not limited to cushions, trampolines, or parachutes to break falls, stretching themselves between tree limbs or rocks to act as slingshots, encircling an attacker's limbs to restrain them, or the entire body to squeeze and render them unconscious. Gloop is the larger of the two. Here's my theory on Gloop and Gleep. I think they're father and son, mother and son, big sister, little sister, big brother, little brother. I honestly think that they, and these are the two you normally see communicating with each other all the time, although Xandor and the humans can communicate with them all. But I see these characters as something incredible. I have a couple videos I'm going to show you guys shortly, but I'm just trying to get through as much of this information as I possibly can before Warner Brothers say to us, hey, what are you doing? Anyway, look at Gloop and Gleep. That's probably mother and son.
Mm-hmm. I can buy that.
Yeah, yeah. Rose, I didn't ask you this, but you are familiar with the Herculoids, correct?
You know, I've never seen an episode of the Herculoids.
I heard about
them when we started doing this show almost 2 years ago. Yes, yes.
Oh, my God.
But you know what? I really like the premise that technology is the villain, so to speak.
Yeah.
I think,
and moving off of Gloop and Gleep here for a second, I think originally the Herculoids were basically colonists. They were the advanced troops sent down to an M-class planet to basically render it, capable of handling settlers.
I agree.
I think that's probably what they did, although they've been on this one single planet for two freaking seasons. I think they were colonists, an advanced team of colonists who went down. And of course, there were these invaders who were all around space and probably happen chance over this planet who had the Herculoids. Although some of the villains knew Xandor and his troop, very, very personally. So go ahead.
How about this? What if they're park rangers?
If they're park rangers, man, they're lousy in obtaining more animals because
No. It's a natural preserve. They're to preserve the planet because they're worried about extinctions and all that. So it's a nature preserve. So they just let the animals go and do what they want to do.
I gotcha. I had up the wrong file when I was talking about these characters, so I'm just going to go ahead and show you guys real quick what I had set up. For each one of these characters, I went on and downloaded some images for you guys to take a look at. And these were, this was the file I was looking for, actually. But, yeah, do you think Gloop and Gleep may be male?
They could be.
Some, it depends upon the event.
Genderless. You know, they could be genderless.
Yeah, they could be genderless. I think they're genderless, but they act male or female depending upon the situation.
Right. And here are the slingshots that shoot the same sort of energy pellet-like substances or rocks or whatever that Tundro shoots out of his horn.
Right.
But there's a good a picture there of Tara herself. She's very pretty, you know. But, man.
She's also, don't mess with her.
No. You know what? She's got the freaking strongest thighs in humanity. Because you're going to tell me that you can stay on top of that freaking flying dragon and not accidentally fall off because you couldn't hang on. And they're not hanging on with their hands, mind you. Okay, so they're awesome. So there's Dorno.
Man, they must not like that kid giving him that name.
Well, I'm just wondering if he got on any underwear. You know, and remember, we can't relate this to anything that's been done here on Earth. Okay, these are aliens, as we know.
It's just a loincloth, you know, that's not unusual.
Wait a minute, I think I see a thong line there on the thigh there. And, no?
Okay. That's a Speedo.
Yeah, it's a Speedo. These are like bird people. I forget the name of them, but I remember seeing this episode. But I don't remember a female one, because you can obviously see that's a female bird.
Yeah.
You know, no guy would walk in public with hips like that. Just saying. Okay, of course we got Dorno's always in trouble. Okay, and then here comes Zok. Zok to the rescue.
You know, he doesn't always use his tail either.
Yeah, that's true, because I've seen him use his beams just strictly out of his eyes, but there's a rendition of him just using his tail.
Right.
I've seen him literally use both eye bolts and tail. Mm-hmm. But Zok's a badass dragon, man. I really love it. And, of course, there's my boy, you know, Igu. And if primates are supposed to be close to human in terms of, you know, reasoning and brain power and things of that nature, this is probably a lonely dude. You know, Xandor, you got to get me a chick, man.
But, he's like Kong, you know, he's the last of his kind.
Yeah, like Kong. Yeah, last of his time. He's like, I ain't got nowhere to go. I guess I better protect these people. What else am I going to do? Oh, here, I'm going to punch you. I don't know how old this is. I know it's definitely not from the series, but obviously somebody has seen The Avengers.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Avengers saw this. You know?
Yeah. Obviously, Igu knows that he can't hurt Gloop.
So, yeah.
Of course. And there's Igu's back. Wait till you guys see this documentary that I'm going to play, because it's very interesting and you're going to enjoy it. So bear with me. Now, do me a favor. Follow me. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's on one side. This sucker has 10 legs.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't think anybody doubted you on that one.
Yeah, no, I honestly didn't think about it. I knew he had a lot of legs, but I actually didn't know the number. I didn't know the number 10. You know.
See, now this is an interesting picture, because I had thought on a couple of episodes I'd seen more than one shot coming out of, you know, the horns.
Well, you have. He can shoot in succession.
No. As in shooting out of more than one horn.
Oh no, he's always had one horn.
Really? I seem to have recalled that. Maybe it was an early episode or something. I don't know, maybe I'd be a kid.
Yeah, I'd be interested in seeing that. So, what does Sage say here? Sage said, Gloop and Gleep are my favorites. And I think Gloop and Gleep are my favorites. Okay? And I'm sticking with that.
Sure you are.
I'm not going to change it.
For the next 30 seconds.
Well, thank you. That's right.
I think Gloop and Gleep, you know, although Tundro is badass too, you know, man, I hope he never lays his head in my lap. You know. But look, this is fan art. Okay? This is fan art. I don't think in the cartoon series she had breasts. I'm just saying. I think somebody was a little upset over that. But see, this little rescue scene from either Gloop or Gleep is great. They can duplicate themselves, spit themselves off. You guys remember Silly Putty?
Yes.
Okay, what did you do with Silly Putty?
Besides, make copies of comic.
There you go. Yeah. And that was it. Yeah, because I'm trying to figure out what else did we do with Silly Putty.
Oh, yeah, I threw it at my brother a couple of times.
You can make it into a ball and it would bounce.
Yeah.
It would bounce, yeah. So you had your own. You had your own group of glee. I don't know if Silly Putty was before the Herculoids, which was 66, 67, or actually 67, 68. It probably was, don't you think?
I'm going to look.
Because
I'm going to say it probably was. It's probably was out there a while.
If Silly Putty was created, let's say in the 50s, I think somebody said, hey, why don't we make critters out of Silly Putty? You know, it had the same abilities as Silly Putty. Thus was born Glooper Gleep. Okay, that was the beginning of that. So that worked. Thank you for putting up with me. All right, now, hold on for a sec. Other things about Gloop and Gleep. I'm sorry, other things about the Herculoids, okay? The Herculoids were basically created in the same timeline as Space Ghost, if I had not said that already, okay? So the reason that there were crossover episodes, and something else I'm going to show you guys at the end that I haven't announced yet, was in another timeline. I might as well say that. But the original series consisted of only 18 episodes, consisting of two segments, each of a total of 36 segments, if that makes any sense.
Okay.
So you had two mini episodes per episode, if that makes any sense. That's how you come up with the 36. It ran from September 9th, 1967, which we now know around about when Saturday mornings came about. It was up north. It was always after the Saturday after we've started school. Okay.
Yes.
Down here, we start school in August. So, you know, we didn't have our Saturday mornings starting for us until we've already been in school a month, basically, close to a month, until January 6, 1968. In the 1981, the series was revived and 11 new segments were made and aired as part of Space Stars. You guys remember that series? And what they did, they pulled together a bunch of old cartoons and made into one series called Space Stars. But they did add, I think the Galaxy Trio was in that. Space Ghost was in that. The Herculoids was in that. I think Shazam, but don't quote me on that. I'm not pretty sure.
What's it called?
Space Stars. It was basically the name, like it was Yogi's All-Star Olympics or something like that. Space Stars. All right.
So it was Space Ghost, the Herculoids. Teen Force.
Teen Force. That's it. Not Galaxy
Trio.
They
did the Space Ace and the Space Mutts.
You know who Space Ace was, right?
No.
Based on the video game.
Oh, no. That was horrid.
Yeah.
And then Space Stars finale or something. But, yeah.
Yeah. So that was.
And Messick revised some of his stuff. And same with Gary Owens for Space Ace.
Yes. And that was what I was going to get to with Rose, was basically that was not the voice of Ted Knight. There you go. It was not the voice of Ted Knight, but in fact a lot of the narration was done by Gary Owens, who did a lot of other narration. Wait till you hear this video, which I'm going to play. Holy crap, I'm going to make an hour. Okay. All right, so the Herculoids made other appearances in the cartoon world, shall I say. They had their own comic books at one time. The episode that they appeared in Space Ghost was called The Molten Monsters of Moltar. And if you watch Space Ghost Coast to Coast, Moltar is one of the sidekicks on that show. He's actually a bad guy. All of them were bad guys, okay? Space Ghost enemies. So The Molten Monsters of Moltar is where the Herculoids made an appearance, if anybody wants to Google that and see if they can watch it. Let's see. He was in several. Herculoids were in several episodes of Space Ghost Coast to Coast. Gloop is mentioned by name and features prominently in the C-Lab 2021 episode "Hail Squish Face."
But C-Lab 2021 was basically Cartoon Network's attempt at parodying.
Yes, because it was not C-Lab 2020. It wasn't right. Parody. Gloop also makes an appearance on Harvey Birdman, Attorney at Law, another parody. The Herculoids were mentioned in an episode of The Venture Brothers. And Tundro and Gloop appeared in an episode of Family Guy. Okay. 8 simple rules for buying my teenage daughter. Okay. So Gloop was literally the babysitter.
Gloop fails. Dear God in heaven.
Yeah, Gloop fails to get a babysitting job from Lois. In protest, Tundro shows up and fires his energy rocks at Lois. So I thought that was pretty awesome. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and finish out on the Herculoids. And I got something else to share with you guys afterwards, but I want you guys to take a look at this doc. It's about 4 minutes, so if anybody got to go to the bathroom, I beg you not to miss it, but I can understand if you need to leave. So take a can't do this yet. Let me advance here. Excuse me, guys.
Oh, by the way, Mike says the Silly Putty was created in 1943.
Wow. Correct. Yes.
Holy mackerel. Very good. 1943. I wasn't around. Were you around, Jerome?
Only in thoughts.
Oh, there you go. It's the grandparents' thoughts, I'm sure. All right. So I want you guys to take a look at this documentary. Enjoy it. It's very good. And it will tell you a little bit more of the Herculoids and how they were created, who the creators were. There's some interviews in here that you guys are going to be interested in seeing. So take a look at this.
In a way, the Herculoids is like the ultimate Saturday morning cartoon. It's got all your fantasies about what you'd want to be if you were a superhero, or the sidekicks you'd want to have.
It was an attempt to get more into the action genre, you know, because they'd been doing all these comedies for so long. And the big thing about Bill and Joe was that they were always trying to diversify. They were always branching out in different directions.
Herculoids is sort of dinosaurs meet the future. It takes place in space or on another planet, and yet the people in it are like cavemen, and they have sort of prehistoric animals, but they're futuristic prehistoric animals, and most of their adversaries are like alien types.
And anybody that landed on the planet was like, no, we don't want you here, and we're going to take care of you, and we're going to make sure that you don't come back, or we're going to destroy you in the process.
The planet's under attack.
But from where and by whom?
We've got to find that out quickly or be destroyed.
There was a weirdness factor to the Herculoids I really liked. I liked the rhino that could just shoot things out of its horn, and the dragon and everything.
It's just nonstop things blowing up. Igu's throwing logs, and Zok is shooting at him, and Tundro's hitting him with the little firebomb things, and Gloop and Gleep are throwing things.
Herculoids represented to me just this kind of unfettered love for monsters. Not only are the good guys monsters, but they're going to face some other bad guy who's going to be some visiting monster. There'll be robots, or there'll be, you know, some one-eyed electric creature or whatever. And if you look at how they fight, they basically end up doing what you do, you know, when you draw little monsters on your lined paper in school. You just kind of go like, boo, 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 bee, bee, and you shoot different lasers at them.
Quick, behind that rock.
That was another Alex Toth design show, and everything Alex did was good. A lot of those shows are amazing because Toth was a guy with a serious adventure background, and some of the animators who had to work off his model sheets were Yogi Bear artists. If you didn't know how to draw adventure stuff, Alex would teach you how to from his models. And he also gave some hands-on instruction to a lot of these guys and helped them out.
A lot of the monsters that you see in Alex Toth's work and in shows like Frankenstein Jr. and Herculoids, they really are Harryhausen-influenced monsters. These are Western American monsters. And there was a rise of a love of dinosaurs at the time. That was like a really big explosion in the 60s among the youth. And it was the same thing that Harryhausen was tapping in Beast from 20,000 Fathoms and 1 Million Years BC. The whole goal as a kid was just to see a monster.
Others come, Krokar, mighty animals.
They're our friends, Krokar. You haven't a chance.
Alex kind of redefined the superhero idea for limited animation.
He's probably one of the single most influential guys in the Hanna-Barbera canon as far as the live-action characters go, any of the superhero stuff, any of these Herculoid space shows. It was full of Alex Toth.
It was doing real people in animation, and that's not as easy as it sounds because real people don't look good in animation, and so you have to work a lot on it. The earlier stuff was all comic characters, funny animals. And people are more forgiving with funny animals. They have different expectations.
At that time, that was refreshing on Saturday morning. There had not been a show with animated dinosaurs and spaceships and bizarre creatures wandering around. So all of a sudden, it was new for Saturday morning. I mean, a few years later, every show was doing that. But at the time, that was the first time we'd seen that kind of stuff animated.
Oh, that was quick. Okay, that went by faster than I thought, to be honest with you guys. Hold on, guys. I had you muted for a sec. Hold on. So what did you think about the documentary, folks?
Not long enough.
Yes, I agree. There could be more, and it was not.
It was really well done. I would like to see a longer version of that.
Yeah, same and here. I don't know if one exists because no way. I don't know where this showed up. If it was on TV, where? And if so, I don't think they would have done such a short version.
Oh, it had to be Cartoon Network, and it had to be like a or what's the other one the other
Boomerang,
cartoon?
Boomerang.
I might have been on Boomerang when Boomerang was still on cable as, you know, like that 5-minute filler between shows or something.
Yes. Okay. Now comes my surprise. Let me put my name up here so you guys
dun,
know who
dun,
I am.
Dun.
All right. So because I didn't think I had an hour's worth, I actually thought I had a 30-minute show, but it just goes to show how important and how valuable co-hosts are because they literally fill in time. And I shouldn't imagine myself speaking for 30 minutes because that's all I had was 30 minutes worth of material. You add more time to it when you have rebuttal from my co-host. So I really appreciate you guys for helping me out on this. And I still want to get to the second piece here. So I need probably about maybe 10 minutes of your time. The next thing that I am about to show you guys. Oh, this is what I want to do. Where? Can't do it like that yet. Okay.
He really needs somebody to run the panel, the control panel for him.
I know, because I need octopus arms too and another laptop. You'd be surprised what I go through when I do these shows. But this is another show, okay, that happened out of the same catalog of Hanna-Barbera that a lot of people don't know about. I'm sure Jerome will, okay? I don't think Rose will. But I'm going to talk a little bit about this other show. And the reason I'm talking about this show is because even though Space Ghosts and the Herculoids are in a galaxy far, far away in another time that we have no idea when, where, how, there is actually and it's not even a superhero rendition of it. It's another Hanna-Barbera cartoon, Saturday morning cartoon show, which I happen to enjoy, that happened on Earth. Okay, it doesn't really matter what decade. You can probably see modern day for them would have been the 60s, but it happened on Earth. So I'm going to talk really quickly in a little bit about this show.
Forced to parachute from a disabled plane, a young boy lands in a mysterious prehistoric valley filled with hidden dangers. When a saber-toothed tiger attacks, he is saved by a giant caveman. And so begins the friendship and adventures of Dino Boy and Ugg the Caveman in the Lost Valley.
Rose? Rose?
Uh-oh. Did we lose Rose?
Oh, just when I needed a comment from her. Oh, my God. Okay, she'll pop back in shortly.
But we showed this entry when we did the dinosaur show that we did.
I'm pretty sure we did. Yeah, that's why I know I don't have to spend that much time on it. but the reason I brought that up, because during that time, and I'll wait until Rose show back up. During that time, let's see. Let me pull it up now. Hanna-Barbera had did a series. Oh, hold on. Stay. Had did a series of what we call bumpers. Okay. Yeah. And bumpers were in between commercials. You know, a commercial is about to come on and it's like, yeah, but watch this first and we'll be back to you after we're done trying to sell you more cereal. And they come up with this specific bumper, which is a crossover that wouldn't happen. And the reason I say it wouldn't happen, because I told you in the beginning, Space Ghosts and Herculoids were within the same time zone. this was not, but yet they made a bumper of it.
Oh, yeah.
Adventure in the prehistoric land of the Lost Valley with Dino Boy. Adventure in the world of tomorrow with the Space Ghost. Before your eyes, see the fantastic come to life. Stay tuned for Dino Boy and the Space Ghost.
It's funny how they said "and the Space Ghost," you know, as well.
Well, it's
I'm
like,
gonna show you that.
It's go like they used to call him the Batman.
The Batman, right. Whoops. Stop. Okay. Here's another bumper that I thought was really interesting and based on the same two characters. Once again, that would never happen because they weren't within the same time zone. I don't even think they were in the same universe, but yet Space Ghost saves the day. And standby, guys. I'm trying to... Okay, here we go. And yet another bumper. And
did you notice that at one point, though, when Space Ghost's ship was flying down, it's shooting, right?
Yeah.
He was shooting in time with the music.
Yeah. And pretty hard to do without any computers back then.
Well, you know, he just, you know, Space Ghost is a hip guy. He really knew how to kick into that music, you know?
Yeah. So Dino Boy actually played during Space Ghost. It debuted. That's the only way you could see it. And it was sandwiched between two episodes of Space Ghost. So you get an episode of Space Ghost, you get Dino Boy, and then you get another episode of Space Ghost, which probably equated to 45 minutes, another 15 minutes for commercials. So there was your hour show right there, you know.
Right, and they called those segments.
Yeah, the segments. It's probably less than 15 minutes, too. I don't even think those segments were 15 minutes long. I think they were less than that, thus a 30-minute show.
I'm sorry.
So those things happen. So you see a little bit of Dino Boy and Ugg, who was the caveman who rescued him. This episode was the Ant People. I think they were called the Ant People.
Yep.
And as you
there
can
was
see,
that whole everybody back then had to do something with like Lilliputians and stuff. So
right. You know. And when Ugg was captured by these bird people, there's Dino Boy who goes to rescue his friend Ugg. And of course Bronte. Don Messick was in fact the voice of Bronte as well. So Don Messick was very, very, you know, creative.
Don Messick was really good at animals.
He was good at voices, period. So,
oh yeah, there's no denying that.
So you see a little bit about that, and Rose may not return, but that's okay. Cause I am at the end of show.
I do have an announcement to make.
Go ahead.
That later today. No.
Sorry.
Today at 2 o'clock, I'll be on Reels and Heels.
Oh, yes. Reels and Heels are doing something about blockbuster movies.
Yeah.
All right. So make sure you pick up Jerome on Reels and Heels. I do want to show you guys one more.
Yeah. Brian, the host, and I had a lengthy conversation yesterday. So we'll see how that turns out.
Good. So that'll be at 2 o'clock, right? I should be around. So I'll pop in and listen. Whoops. Let me show you guys, since I was on bumpers, we're going to end this with one or two more bumpers that I have here. And I'm trying to gear into. Okay, now where are you?
So watch this space, around Labor Day. We'll be back.
Yes, we will be back, as well as Dragon Con having a virtual con.
Which, hey, speaking of virtual cons, did you see any of the Comic Con virtual stuff?
No, but I've read reviews.
I watched, because of the nature of our show, I watched the one that they did for the new Warner Brothers cartoons.
Oh, the Looney Tunes?
Yeah, the new Looney Tunes one.
How was it?
It was horrid.
Okay, now let me go ahead and give you my review. Okay, now that just goes to show how good we are at what we do, because I've heard nothing but horrid things about all of the Comic-Con
panels.
Virtual. I'm not bashing them. I just think planning should have been a little bit more.
I agree.
Into that. Some of it was pre-taped, right?
Some of it was. Some of it wasn't. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm not a fan.
But they were all, even when they were live, they were taped for later showing. That's how I got to see this one.
I am not a fan of these virtual cons that's been happening, and it's sad. I think they could have really did it a little better, in my opinion.
Some of the cons do really well with it because they think about what are the fans going to want?
Yeah, I think a few of these other ones out there are doing very well. Hey, guys, look at this bumper real quick, and we'll say goodbye to you, so stand by. Bear with me, guys. I'm fumbling here. My God,
I want a car that makes that kind of noise that when I pass something.
Scared the hell out of me. yeah, if that happened. So, look, we did our last show before summer hiatus, just to let you guys know if you popped in a little late. We're going to take about a month off. You'll see us back around Labor Day, actually the week before. I think Labor Day's second week in September this year, I think.
I don't know. I have to look at the calendar.
Yeah, but either way, you'll see us back then with some brand new stuff and some interesting stuff. And I just want to thank all you guys for putting up with us and the wild that you've been seeing us, which I have no idea how long that's been. Long, you know. And you know, once Rose gets her act, oh look. She popped in. Hold on.
Excellent. Bring her back up, please.
Unsolo this.
Yay! Rose is back.
I'm so sorry I missed the end of the show. We got bumped off, and I was thinking to myself, "Oh, things went so well," and then that happened.
that's okay. You know, we miss you, but we know you're there. We just showed one bumper of Space Ghost and Dino Boy. I moved into Dino Boy. That was the.
I started watching Dino Boy, and I got cut off. So.
Right. Well, we just showed a few clips of that because we did another segment on that before when we were talking about our dinosaurs. But other than that, right now, we're just saying our goodbyes and seeing our friends in about another month. You have 30 days off, guys. So if you got to go shopping on early Saturday mornings, we're not going to stop you.
go do your Christmas shopping.
We're
going
to miss you guys.
Now.
We're going to miss you. But, you know, have a good month off from us. But you can catch us on YouTube.
Yes, through HWWS we put these back up. Let me go ahead and hit this here. But we thought. No, thank you. But we'll see you guys in about 30 days. In the meantime, I'm going to work on my tan because I have a big beach trip that's coming up the middle of the month for my birthday, and then.
Yeah, you're getting very pale.
I am. I'm really disgusted. You know, I can't see myself in a mirror anymore. It really sucks. Well, actually, that's a good thing. I can't see myself in a mirror anymore.
Trust me, you don't want to see this shirt come off. It's like you know, when they light the fires for Gondor, you know?
Yeah, you are such a ginger, man. I know. I don't want to see you with your shirt off either. I wouldn't mind seeing Rose with her shirt off, but I mean you.
Okay, I think we're starting to cross a line
Now that we're talking about skin tones here, you know? Yeah. But okay, so everybody that's listening, thank you so much for joining us. I'm hoping we got away from Warner Brothers doing this broadcast. I haven't gotten any emails, but who knows?
No, I think we did well. I think we did.
Or the letter did well, put it that way. So
I think the letter might help also.
It might have helped, but I don't see any. Let me hold my breath. I don't see anything in my mail from them yet. So that probably went good. All right. So, guys, see you next week. Sorry.
No.
See, I'm so used to it.
See you next month.
See you next month. And thank you for joining. See you in September. Thank you for joining us for Saturday Morning Cartoons. It's Jerome's turn when we come back.
Oh, so no.
Jerome has a whole month to put
to
together
figure it
this
out.
Next show.
Me too.
It's really going to suck.
Yeah, you have a month and a week, Rose. Okay. I have a month and a half. And we will see you guys in a month. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Stand by.